Welcome to the Cisco NETACAD CCNA Introduction to Networks video series by Jason Johnson. This video is Chapter 6, The Network Layer. The material in this video covers the 6.0 version of Cisco NETACAD CCNA Introduction to Networks course. I want to thank you for watching the videos. Your time is appreciated. And if you find the material helpful, you can subscribe to my channel. And remember to click the notification button if you want to see when I post new content. If you have any questions, you can leave a comment below. And if you watch to the end of the video, I'll have links to the next chapter. So let's take a look now at Chapter 6. Let me get the PowerPoint going here. I didn't have that started. And we are going to look at Chapter 6, the network layer. And we have four sections to this chapter. You have 6.1, the network layer protocols. And we're essentially doing the layer 3 in this video. Describe the purpose of the network, IPv4, v4 versus v6. We're going to take a look at routing. Routers and configuring a Cisco router. And so configuring the initial settings on a Cisco IOS router, you're going to be doing that in your NETACAD course in the labs in there. You're going to be going in and configuring that. So we're going to do a presentation look at that in this video. So 6.1, network layer protocols. So what is the network layer? The network layer is the layer 3 of the OSI model, and we have a good visual here. So in the previous presentation or the previous chapter, chapter 5, we looked at the physical and the data link layer, and we looked at switches in previous chapter and how those worked. Well, in this video, we're going to look at the networking layer, and the networking layer provides end-to-end transport processes. It addresses end devices, it encapsulates, it routes, and it de-encapsulates. So the layer of protocols that we're going to talk about and use here are the IPv4 and IPv6. I'm going to refer to those as V4 and V6, just so you know. So if I don't say IPv4, I just shorten it because it's easier to say V4, V6. Now, in this case, the layer 4 is going to encapsulate data. It's going to take the data and encapsulate it and send it down to the network. The network's going to encapsulate the information and say, okay, here's my IP addressing and so forth. And then the layer 2 is going to put the MAC addressing information, and then it's going to send it down to the physical medium. So let's talk about the characteristics of the IP protocol. So when we encapsulate the IP, segments are encapsulated into IP packets for transmission, and the network layer adds a header so packets can be routed to the destination. Now, if you have IP connectionless, it means the sender doesn't know if the receiver is listening or the message arrived on time. The receiver doesn't know anything of the data is coming. So IP connectionless, when you hear IP connectionless, you just mean that nobody really cares. I mean, it cares because it's trying to send the information, but it just sends it. It's in the United States, when you send a piece of mail to the postal service, you just put a piece of mail in your mailbox. They pick it up that morning. The person may or may not know that they're getting a piece of mail on the other end, and that mail just shows up. That's connectionless. But if you go to the post office and you say, I want to send this piece of mail, but I want a return receipt, and so it gets there, and the person that receives the piece of mail signs a piece of paper and says, yes, I've received this, and then you get it back. That would be connection. This is connectionless that we're talking about, so it just, they don't care. So IP best effort delivery means there's no guarantees that the delivery are going to be made. Think about the time when you tried to access a website, and you went and you typed in the website address, and then it come back up and it said destination site, couldn't bring it up, or the web page didn't pull up, or everything on the web page didn't pull up. That's best effort. It just gives you what it can give you, and that's it. It just says, I'm going to give you what I can, and I'm not going to care about the rest. Now, also, it's media independent, so IP can travel over different types of media. It doesn't care if it's copper or if it's wireless or fiber optics. It's going to be media independent on there. Now, if we look at the V4 packet, the V4 packet's been around a long time. It's being phased out because V6 is coming in because we ran out of V4 addresses, but it's going to be around for a long time. So you do need to, I wouldn't say you need to memorize this packet header and packet information here, but I would be very familiar with this layout. So I would spend some time looking at this from an exam standpoint and just from a knowledge standpoint. If you're going to go on to take the CCNA, you need to be very familiar with the packet on here. You don't need to memorize every piece of it in here, but you need to be very familiar with it because you are going to get questions about that, and you are going to be you're going to need to have some knowledge of it. So it looks at the version of the V4, what version of V4 you might get, what differentiated service, the total length of the packet is going to be given, so that on the other end they're going to be like, oh, okay, now I know what the link's supposed to be. Time to live just means it's not going to hang out on the network forever. It's just going to say it's got so this thing's got so long to live, and if it doesn't get there in an amount of time, it's just going to die. The reason for that is if you don't want packets just floating around forever and gumming up everything and just causing problems. So after a certain amount of time, those packets will die. And then you have your source IP address and your destination IP address. Now the v6 packet, and we're going to have to go to the next one. I'm going to go ahead and talk about the v6, and the picture is on the next page, so we'll just talk about that. It's coming around because v4, the address pool has been depleted, and so lack of end-to-end connectivity on IPv4. So v6 has come along. It's got an increased address space. I'm not going to lecture in here about the size of it, but it's astronomical. It's really hard to wrap your head around how many addresses are in the v6 address space. It has improved packet handling, and it eliminates the need for network address translation. You don't have to do NAT tables anymore, which is nice, because every device can have a v6 address. So encapsulating the v6, you have a simplified header format. They've simplified things. It's more. There's no checksum process. It's more efficient, and the flow label fill makes it more efficient as well. So they just really cleaned it up and made the whole process a lot better. Now, when we're looking at the header here, you can see, and I'm not going to flip back to the V4, but you can do that. You can go back on your video, or you can go into the NETACAD course and pull these two up. You can see that it's much more simplified here. You have your version, you have your flow label, you have your length, your next header, and your hop limit. And hop limit is the same as your time to live. It's not the same. It fulfills the same function of the time to live. It just says, here's your hop limit, and after it gets to that limit, it'll die. And then you have your source IP address and your destination IP address. Okay, so we've looked at V4, we've looked at V6. Let's take a look at routing. So when we route, we are leaving the local area network, and we need to forward that information, and there needs to be a decision about that. So there's three types of destination. You can send it to itself, the local host, or a remote host. And routing, that's what a router does. It says, okay, is this information for me? Is this information that needs to just be left on the local host and I'm not going to do anything with it again? Or do I need to send it out to my remote host or my remote connections? And so you can set up a default gateway, and you'll hear the term default gateway. That's typically a router that goes outside the local area network. It routes traffic to other networks. It has a local IP address right here. It has a local IP address right there. It has a local IP address in the same address range as other hosts on the network. And the reason you do that is because these devices need to be able to see it. If it has an IP address outside the range, it wouldn't be able to see it. So it's got to be inside that same local area network. And it can take data in and forward data out. So it's a gateway. It's a gatekeeper. It says, okay, it pretty much tells what goes in and out of the system. So using the default gateway, host will use the default gateway when sending packets to remote host. And the host routing tables, you can use the netstat command, netstat-r, to display the host routing table on a Windows machine. And you can try that out on your Windows machine. You got the same thing. Linux does it. You got the same thing in Mac as well. But on the Windows, it's netstat-r to look at your routing table. This is what a routing table on a Windows machine would look like. You do your netstat-r right there. And this is a V4 route table here, and it's just going to say, here's the table that I've built up. Here's the information. I've got these IP addresses. There's the interface that it goes to, and just gives your information on there. Now, router routing tables, say that fast really a whole bunch of times. Router routing tables, they have a forwarding decision to make. Routers and hosts forward packets in a similar fashion. The main difference is that routers have more interfaces while hosts have only one. So devices on a directly connected network can be reached directly. Devices on a remote network are reached through a gateway. So you have to go through some kind of routing to get there. So V4 routing table, the router routing table stores information that the router knows about. And on the Cisco router, you can do show IP route to display the routing table. And the table also has information on how the route was learned, its trustworthiness, and a rating on it. And it also contains which interface to use to reach that specific destination. Directly connected routing table entries, you'll have a C or an L. C identifies a directly connected network. It's automatically created when an interface is connected with an IP address and activated. The L identifies that this is a local interface, and that's V4 address of the interface on the router. Now, when we look at remote network routing table entries, remote destinations can't be reached directly, so they have to be routed. Remote routes contain the addresses of the intermediate devices to be used to reach the destination. So for example, the route, so this router right here, this router knows nothing about these devices over here. It knows nothing about them. So this router says, hey, I've got a packet, but I've got an IP. Let's just say that this end device here is trying to get over to this device right here. So this, let's just say this one is trying to reach out and go over here. So this device says, hey, I'm trying to get over there. Here's my information. The router says, okay, well, it's not on the local. So let me forward this on to my known destinations, and I'm going to forward it to this next router over here. Well, this router picks it up and says, hey, wait a minute, I know that IP address. It's on my routing table, and I'm going to forward it on internally. And then the switch then forwards it on through based on MAC addressing, based on that ARP table that we talked about in the previous chapters, where you have an ARP table and an IP address that are known, and then it can forward it to that. So you also have next hop address, and this would be a next hop address. This router knows nothing about over here, but it knows its next hop address, and that's what it would forward it to. Now let's take a look at routers, the physical routers. Anatomy of a router, and this is a pretty good picture of one. This is the case been pulled off of a Cisco router here. They have a CPU, they have memory, they have input-output devices. They use an operating system, or they use iOS as their operating system. You have fans in them, you have power supplies, you have your RAM built in. You have all of your information there that's built in. It doesn't look exactly like a PC because you don't have removable sticks of memory. You can plug memory in or memory sticks to do that, but for your main RAM, it's built into the board. But just as a computer, routers have memory. They have RAM, ROM, and NV, and flash memory. And they have the same general structure for the most part when we're talking about Cisco routers. So connecting to a router, they have lots of ports that support different types of connections. And you have LAN and WAN interfaces. Routers have LAN and WAN ports, LAN being local, WAN being wide area. And different models ship with different ports depending upon the age. And so you can't really just show all the models here, but depending upon the lab that you're working in, or you just can go out and search on the internet for different types of routers and different types of interfaces. But Ethernet's a very common on different router models, or most router models, the models that you're going to see. Now, when you're talking about the software, we looked at the hardware, but when we're talking about the software, the iOS image file is stored in the flash. It contains the iOS. That's the flash right there, memory, and it contains the iOS and other system-related files. The flash also stores system files that they need, and NVRAM stores the configuration parameters. So your startup config is here in NVRAM. And then you have your random access memory. This is your running memory. That gets reset every time the device reboots. So when your flash, it boots up and it says, okay, I'm going to go to my flash. What image do I have? Let me load that. Do I need to load any other system files? Then I'm going to go down here and pick up my configuration file and start running that. So I'm going to have my Cisco iOS running, my running config, and any changes I make here, remember, you need to save those to your startup config, or the next time you reboot, those won't work. You can also do a show version output. You can do a show version on the router to be able to see which version of iOS you're running. When we talk about configuring a Cisco router, there's some basic switch configurations that you need to do. I would just recommend writing these down and having, they talk about having an engineer journal or something along those lines. I keep a little notebook of basic commands just so that I have a checklist, because my memory is not as good. I mean, it's not like a computer. I don't remember everything. So I need to have a list of, when I go down through and check everything. So you configure your device name. You secure your exec mode, you secure your lines, you secure your privileged exec mode, secure all your passwords, provide your legal notification, your banner, configure the management SVI, and then save the configuration to from running to your stored configuration file. And so it's the same, it's pretty much the same from switch to router. You've got pretty much the same ones there, device name, so forth. So they're pretty much the same on both routers and switches. There's some different things that you're going to do, a few different things that you're going to do on the router based on your VLANs and some other things. Well, you're going to have VLANs on your switches too, but based upon your default gateway settings and things like that, you're going to have some different things on routers than you have on your switches. But for the most part, the basics are the same. Now, when you configure your router interfaces, you're going to add a description to the interface. That's optional, but I would always do a description to the interface, or you can. You configure your V4 and V6 address. You activate the interface with a no shutdown, because your interfaces are shut. They're shut off by default. So you have to do the no shutdown command to bring them online. So this is a typical how you would do. You would do your config T here, configuration terminal. This router's been renamed to router 1. You go in here and you type interface gigabit ethernet 00. You put your IP address, your V4 address in here. Your description, link to LAN 10. That's your description. It's optional. You don't have to do that, but you do. And then you do the no shutdown. And now that interface is going to come up. You're going to see the change state to up. And now you'll be able to ping that. If you have an ethernet connection to that, you're going to be able to ping that. And you can also verify the configuration. You can show IP route. You can do show interface, and you can show your IP interface as well. That'll display the V4 statistics for all interfaces on a router. Now, configuring the default gateway. If you have a router that's going to be a default gateway, you have to set up, it's required for remote network communication. So if you're going to go outside your local area network, you have to have a default gateway. If a switch is to be managed by its VTY lines, it needs to have a default gateway to be able to get in and do that. And you can use the IP default gateway command to configure the gateway switch. And you're going to learn about that in your reading and in your labs for Chapter 6. You're going to learn how to do that. But if you're just pinging a localhost, see, the switch just manages that. But if you're going outside the localhost or remote, you're going to have that default gateway so that it can go out. All right, so that concludes Chapter 6. We have looked at how network layer protocols and communication across data networks, across data networks, explain how routers enable end-to-end connection, explain how devices route traffic, and then configure a router with basic configuration. So I hope this video was helpful for you. If it was, give it a like below, and make sure that you keep watching my videos. I do appreciate it, and I hope you have a great day.